husband or wife, like, make your shadow like night at high noon. You know, you though some I can't blot off some of it getting that large. But anyway, or the Moabite fugitives, we know there's no country of Moab now. So we have to get historical. And Isaiah's preaching in a time in chapter 16 is given to Isaiah and to the people of God at a time in the Middle East that the Assyrians, coming not even out of Damascus, but out of Nineveh, the Assyrians were busy becoming one of the world's first superpowers. And they had an army that was notable, even in ancient times, for how cruel they were, how ruthless and pitiless toward prisoners and people that they defeated for their appalling tactics in battle. And they were busy conquering city after city after city. And they had descended like a hurricane upon the country of Moab. And the primary reason there is no country of Moab right now. The Assyrians did away with it. It's Moab, and the Moabites were neighbors to Jerusalem and Israel, and had been for a time out of mind. And so what's happened is that Assyrian army has come down upon Moab, is busy destroying its cities, and the people are fleeing, wouldn't you? Okay, Assyrian warriors were scary individuals, and so the people are fleeing. You know, their defenses have fallen, and so you have a picture in Isaiah 16 of just all these Moabite women and children clustered at the banks of the Jordan, ready to cross into Israel for safety and shelter. Now, this is where it gets interesting, because the Middle East of the day, this is about 2,500 years ago, was no nicer place than it is now. And we found that you have conquering and intrigue and cities and countries ranged against other cities and countries. And now there would be a common wisdom in a situation that's so volatile and so prone to violence and people just becoming strong and taking from other people exactly what they want, everything they could, is that if the Assyrians were attacking Moab, well, that's Moab's hard luck. I mean, that's just it for them. And Isaiah, you even have to get into the context here that Isaiah had told the king of Israel, and Isaiah was noted for being right when he said things, that the Assyrian army would not come here. You know, they look scary, they look like there's a big deal, but in Jerusalem, he won't come. And Isaiah was right. So the Israelites could look on this, and the king of Jerusalem is saying, well, I'm not going to bother the Assyrians. And why should I help anybody? I reference the Game of Thrones, and I think a clarification is necessary. I've seen bits of the Game of Thrones. I do not recommend you see it. If you want to know why I wouldn't recommend you see the whole show of the Game of Thrones, I can unpack that, but it would be unseemly just now to go into detail. What seems to drive the plot, though, and what seems to be compelling is the idea of this power, this family, this person plotting against this other family and power person, and then there's another one that's allied with this one here, but they might double-cross one another. There's ruthlessness. There's people taking powerful chances. There's people risking all to attain ultimate power. And this is one of the advices the world gives. You know, Machiavelli, in writing The Prince in Italy's days of one city warring against another, just said, your first job is to become secure in your own power, and then your next job is to make your neighbors weak. And when you have conquered them and got them firmly under thumb, you have other neighbors and make them weak and conquer them and keep them under your thumb. That's the only way the prince can stay secure upon his throne. Isaiah doesn't see it that way. He says, the oppressor will come to an end. Destruction will cease. The aggressor will vanish. when the power that is invisible in the world. We grieve over wars. We fear the rumors of wars. We suffer along with and try to aid populations devastated. So he's saying, there is a reality that comes from God that makes this human power of no account. Because he says, one will sit upon the throne of David. And his kingdom is one of love and peace. And Isaiah has a proposal. This is his idea. He's saying, take these fugitives in. Take the refugees in. Make your shadow like the night and high noon. That doesn't mean be fat, without the sun. It means shelter them. Now, to add one more historical thing here, Isaiah is a very tolerant prophet then. The Moabites were not of Israel's religion. Their religion would be, if you had a good look at it, it would be a mixture of cruelty, superstition, weird sorts of witchcraft, and depravity. Just acts that you would consider abominable. That was Moabite religion. And had not then, at different times, infected Israel. Moabites had been political enemies of Israel from time to time, and had, when they had the advantage, had come into Judah, Jerusalem, and the lands there, and took what they wanted, and enslaved people, and done very cruel and heartless things. Moabites were not their people or their race. And think about Isaiah. Is there any more serious worshiper of God than Isaiah in his day? He isn't. Probably not. Isaiah chapter 6, he'd gone into church and this is the spiritual life of Isaiah. He had wandered into church and there was God. That's chapter 6 in Isaiah. Pretty impressive story there. It took a grip upon his life and he never changed from that point on. Isaiah knows that God should be worshipped. Isaiah knows that God's law is true. Isaiah knows that the people of God were meant to be centered around him. But notice, he says, bring those people, not our religion, not our race, not anything to do with us, back to former enemies. Bring them in. Because they have need. Pretty powerful stuff. Pretty different stuff than you might see in every day for a religious leader, political, powerful figure. Now, going to the next screen, we have an explanation why that might be. Because Isaiah had actually been following the law given by Moses. That love your neighbor as yourself, Jesus says it. That's Mark 12:31. But he quotes it from the book of Leviticus, where all the laws are written out, all the things that you're to do and to not do. Things that you know that a person should stay away from because there's a boundary around that in which you should not cross. The law had a positive command. Love your neighbor as yourself. The law had other commands that we do not recall as often. Because Israel, God's people, were an unusual nation. They were designed to be tolerant of people who were different from them. There are the number 52. There are 52 laws in the words of Moses that tell people to treat the stranger, the one who is not of Israel, not a worshiper of God, to treat the stranger fairly. No idea that one law applies to another just as well. Everybody has some rights. And so that idea that you find in U.S. history that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, which is life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Determination by the first Americans when their constitution was ratified to pass a Bill of Rights, which said equal protection under the law, freedom of speech, let people speak, freedom of religion, let people worship the way they need to worship, freedom of assembly, let them gather together. These things providing this tolerance that the Torah, that the law of God for the people of Israel had. It was a remarkable feat for the first Americans, because at the time the colonies became the United States of America, about 30% of the people didn't even speak English. German immigrants, immigrants from everywhere, spreading throughout the frontier. They did a great job. Now, Israel also was never designed to be an empire. You know, the story is driven here in Isaiah 16 about the Assyrians going forward and grabbing everything they can. If they conquered one city, they said, what's over the hill? Another city? Oh, do it. We're going to go conquer them. And Israel was never designed to do that, and never did. Was they had their boundaries that they were supposed to be in, where they passed through the thicket to Canaan and occupied those boundaries. Israel had 52 laws saying that a stranger who lives in your land, somebody who's come here and lived, freedom's fair. They live under the same set of rules you live under. They had two laws that said, you know how it says, love your neighbor? That love the stranger. Love them. Twice. And one statement in Leviticus that says, God loves the stranger, the foreigner, the alien. No wonder Isaiah was a tolerant prophet. Because it not only was a national ethic, and that it's very hard to pull that together, how nation is a nation and governs itself and manages the diverse people that live within it and administers laws fairly. It's no easy thing to do. But it also was a personal ethic. You will love the stranger. You will have in your hearts a place that you've made for them, though they don't believe as you do, and they don't look like you do. I'm not saying new things, because we've talked to ourselves since I was a small child about everybody, you can't dwell in a place of darkness and look at people of different color, class, religion, and devalue them. I'm not saying anything more than what you would have heard in school growing up, as I did. But it's interesting that if the law made it a personal ethic, and Jesus made it a personal ethic, something that's got to happen in your life, that you have a love for who is next door, that you have a love for your neighbor, that then Jesus embodied that. Just to keep the confusion that we might be saying neighbors that we like. I have wonderful neighbors, by the way. They've done some nice things. I'm not going to know what they've done. They've been really nice to me this summer. It's great. Okay, and they're all swell, and they stop and talk, and just the best bunch of people. Now, some of us have had neighbors that really keep life from getting monotonous. But just so Jesus making sure that this becomes a personal ethic for us, because there's no talk so much about the nation of Israel shall love its neighbors. No, you love your neighbor as yourself. That's the first and greatest commandment. Well, love God first, then love your neighbor. That's the whole commandment. That's the whole law in the gospel, says Jesus. And he outlines this too. John the Baptist saying, if you have a coat, two coats, share with somebody. Jesus says, boy, if somebody sues you and takes your coat, don't let him have your shirt. I know he hates it. Let him have it. If a soldier comes along and makes you carry his pack for a mile because you were standing there and he didn't want to carry it, well, carry it too. There should be a place in your life where you love people who are strange to you. And now if we go to the third screen, we can meet some strange people. Okay. I love Spider-Man growing up. It was so nice of my brothers to buy the comic books. I didn't buy that many. Villains. People that live wrong. Okay. Now I have the Spider-Man villains because I didn't want to put up pictures of people I actually know. But six people. Realize the church and in the personal life of the Christian, the presence of God. Okay, before I get to the villains, the presence of God has become aggression and military strength have no value because there is something here that is greater than that by far. And this one will establish a throne in love, in faithfulness, in peace. It will seek justice and cause righteousness to be done. And it is the presence of that King, Jesus, that causes everything to be different for Christian, for how we live and how we react. Because we see another source of power that is greater than all other sources of power. We see another reality breaking in upon this world. You know, just turning upside down what Jesus' own people thought being the people of God was all about. They certainly had it in terms of defeating their enemies and making their kingdom secure and securing all the power they could have. Jesus said, no, you're a people belonging to God. Peter would say, you are a kingdom of priests, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. Which is just to restate what the Jews were to be, centered around God in the Old Testament. Jesus makes it a reality, giving us the vision of God as a human being. God's Son, living among us, dying for us, rising again, showing every power he can. And so, one fruit in your life is a place for the other people. Now, in my experience, I thought of six people. One of them was, I remember her. She asked the previous pastor to leave. He was on her porch. He wasn't on there just spitting on her front door or anything. He was just making a call. She didn't want any contact with the church. That's one. I knew a bitter victim of a failed suicide. Cursed at anybody that came in her room. Another man was a cold materialist. I mean, his own family described him as all he cares about is money. All he cares about is reputation in the town and the connections that he made. He cares little for his children and grandchildren and makes everybody's life miserable. It's all about possessions. That's number three. We had a young man that was, you often see people fall in odd religions. His odd religion was a mixture of Christianity and just nearly a white supremacist philosophy. Very, very evil, I think. And there was that young man. That's four. Five was an individual that just was so random in how they responded. They seemingly could never say anything appropriate. That person had a way of making everybody mad. That person had a way of being in social situations where you just wish they were not there. And gave off that kind of aura of very self-centered, very, very not aware of needs of others. And then an extremely unsociable man who again, you couldn't get through. He mocked at prayers. He didn't, care if you were there or not. Couldn't act like he related, showing you any friendliness. The church could never figure out whether he's being abusive to his family members or not. There's a teetering kind of an area there. All six of these people were at one time within the ministry of a church I was part of. Because you need to be, as a church, as a tolerant church, to have a wide ministry circle that includes not only the people you love and like, the people who are supportive to you, the people who make your life cheery, but also needs to be the friends, neighbors, family, and co-workers of those people that you love in life. You just need to have a wide circle of concern that if something happens to them, you care. You're involved in their life. And these people were part of that wider circle of concern. Now, I can assure you that all six of those people ended up with a good and earnest confession of faith in Christ. All those people laid aside so much of what keep them in that circle where they knew we loved them and knew we cared about them.